Hi everyone, welcome to the Jobs of the Future webinar. My name is Natalia Dempsey. I am a student in the Bachelor of IT degree at the University of Newcastle, and I am your lovely MC for the evening. So also joining me tonight, I have Cornelius Partycooper. Feel free to introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Cornelius Partycooper, and I'm in my second year of a Bachelor of Software Engineering. Thanks, Natalia.
Well, good. So we have some housekeeping tonight. So this is a webinar format. It's a bit different from your normal Zoom. So we can't see you, we can't hear you, but we will have the question and answer function open. So later on in the night, we're going to have a Q&A session. Drop your questions in. It'll be brought to the panel to answer. So we'll get to that a bit later. So first up for tonight, we will have Dr. Alex Mendes, who is a senior lecturer in computer science and software engineering. He will give us a talk about how the field of computing and IT is constantly changing and how studying computing and IT here at the Uni of Newcastle can prepare you for a rapidly changing world. Next up after Alex, we will be hearing about a really exciting project from Professor Liliana Brankovic, who is about to talk about computing and IT professionals and how we've all responded to the challenges that the great pandemic has brought on us. After that, we will then open it up to our panel. That's when our Q&A session will happen. And after that, we will have the Kahoot. You get to win some prizes and that. It's a fun little trivia game. So hopefully we can get through this in an hour, but hopefully it'll be a good night. So why don't we pass it on to Dr. Alex Mendes, who give us a talk about the jobs of the future in computing and IT. Welcome, Alex. Take it over.
Okay, thank you, Natalia. Okay, I'm going to share my screen quickly here. Jobs of the future, share. I hope you can all see my slide. Can you all see that? Yep, okay, awesome, excellent. Okay, so welcome everyone to this webinar. So my name is Alex Mendes. I'm with the School of Electrical Engineering and Computing and with the Faculty of Engineering and Built Environment. I'm going to start with some information about the university and our graduates and the students' perception of the university in general. So first piece of good news is that 100% of our graduates, they find full employment within 4 months of graduating. So that comes from the 2019 Graduate Outcome Survey. Actually, many of our graduates, they get, they find their first job before they end their degree. Now, normally in their third year, they are already working part-time, which is pretty awesome. We just got very good news that the university went up 10 positions in the world rankings. So that's for next year, for 2021. So we used to be at position 207, we are now 197. So that put us in the top 200 in the world, which is quite prestigious. And now about students' perception of our degrees, there is this website called The Good Universities Guide. You can search that after we finish here. And there it says that computing, maps, and technology at the universities is the number one in New South Wales for overall education experience and teaching quality. And we are also number one for learning resources and student support. So that again reflects the quality of our teaching here. I'm gonna jump over to some statistics of employment because that's the topic of this talk, of course. If you go to the government website, joboutlook.gov.au, and you search for software and applications programmers, which is pretty much everything related to computing, you see that the average full-time pay is $112,000 per year. So that's 30% more than the average of all Australian jobs. We are also likely to experience low unemployment and a very strong future growth. they are predicting about 16,000 new jobs per year opening for the next 5 years. So there's a very strong demand for new professionals, and that's probably going to continue for a long, long time. 90% of the workforce in our area is full-time, works full-time. The average age is 37, so very young. And so it's roughly 3 years younger than the average of all the Australian, all Australian jobs. Okay, so that was just a few statistics that I wanted to show you. And now I'm going to jump straight into future careers and what you can do and what are the hot topics in computing. I selected five there, but there are many more, but these would be five that really caught my attention. Cybersecurity and Internet of Things, IoT, artificial intelligence and machine learning, full stack development, cloud engineer, and DevOps, which is software development and IT operations. So I'm gonna go quickly through each one of them. Cybersecurity, everybody kind of has a rough idea of what cybersecurity is. So it's how you keep information safe, how you keep your privacy, and so on. And when someone talks about cybersecurity, you think about a hacker, you know, straight away. And that's very true. Cybersecurity refers to the techniques of protecting computers, networks, programs, and data from unauthorized access or attacks that are aimed for exploitation. Cybersecurity is going to become very, very in demand, professionals in that area, as we become more and more connected. We all have our phones, but very soon cars will be connected to the internet. Our home appliances will be connected to the internet. Many people have already bought into the whole Google Home, you know, a frenzy. You know, people have that little box, you know, at home. So that raises a series of issues with cybersecurity and spying and so on. Also, banks, you know, they keep all your records, you know, in their databases. Governments as well with the My Health website. So all of that has to do with cybersecurity. So specialists, professionals in that area will be in high demand. The next one is artificial intelligence, and it is the concept of machines being able to carry out complex tasks in an efficient and smart manner. And machine learning focuses on computing, on a computer making decisions or execute a task using available data. And I put there a picture of a game because, well, everybody loves games. And games, they use AI all the time. Like when you are playing against the computer has built in a AI, you know, module, yeah, that makes it clever, makes your enemies behave in a clever way and so on. But AI will also be present in autonomous cars in the future. We will also help in the area of health. With that, a better diagnosis of diseases using images. People are already working with that at the moment, like trying to take CT scans and mammograms and trying to find, you know, all sorts of diseases. So that's going to be a hot topic as well. Then we have full stack development. And this is a kind of traditional area of computing, of software engineering and computer science and IT, like the three areas. But now it's becoming even more important. Full stack development refers to software development of both client and server sides. So that means both the website, which is what we see when we access the website of a company, and also the database that stays underneath it. You know, like with all the data of the clients, data about the products and so on. In the past, normally companies would hire someone who was just a web specialist, a web page developer, and then someone who would be a database specialist, would have two people working. But now they just want the whole thing and they just hire one person that knows it all. And these professionals are becoming more and more in demand. Then we have cloud engineer, and that has to do with cloud computing, which is another buzzword, you know, at the moment. And then you have Amazon offering those kind of services. You have Microsoft as well. And so that's becoming more and more important. So what is cloud, right? Cloud engineers are responsible for developing solutions that make use of both in-house technology and outside systems in order to design, plan, manage, maintain, and support the business. Cloud computing has become more and more important now because companies, they don't want to support, to keep an IT department, especially if they are small or medium size. It's not really worth to keep 6, 7, 8 professionals just to keep their IT working. So they delegate that to a cloud, to a cloud provider. And then they keep just one person in house, or perhaps two, just to manage this communication between the company systems and the cloud systems. So cloud engineering is very important. It's become more and more important now. And it's gonna be for the next decades. And then we have DevOps, which is software development and IT operations. It's a set of practices that works to automate and integrate the processes between software development and IT teams, so they can build, test, and release software faster and more reliably. The example that I like to give here is everybody here has Windows or Mac or another operating system. So when you install that, every now and then, every few days, you have a message popping up on your screen saying that you have to download some new features or restart. At the same time that people are using software here, that is the whole development team working here in the background, trying to add more features, trying to fix any bugs and so on. And then send those fixes, to the clients. And so this communication has to be controlled or organized in a certain manner, and that's DevOps. You get information about bugs in the system, or you find information about features that your clients want. You communicate that back to the development team. They organize a patch or an update, and then they send that back to the client. So that's DevOps is exactly all of that. You can learn those skills in our computing programs. We offer here three of them, computer science, information technology, and software engineering. We have 4 majors for computer science, 3 majors for information technology, and software engineering has only 1 major, just software engineering. So for instance, computer science, if you choose cybersecurity, that's one of our majors, you can definitely work with cybersecurity and Internet of Things. You get extra courses that will teach you those skills. If you do data science or computer systems and robotics, you will definitely learn a lot of machine learning and artificial intelligence. Full stack development, you can choose either computer science, software development major, information technology, the systems development major. We also allow you to work as a full stack developer or software engineer, engineering. So that's another degree. So that's the more, broader area of work. Cloud engineer, I would definitely say that you should probably choose, again, software development and or software engineering. That those would be the best majors for you. And DevOps, software engineering or IT systems development. But we can have a chat about that later, when we have the Q&A. But pretty much our majors, they match really well those 5 areas of work. And there are many more. In terms of emerging and declining areas, so this comes from the World Economic Forum, and that's the projection for 2022. ICT and computing is going to explode, and other areas, more traditional, will see a decrease in the number of roles or number of positions. So accounting, business, manufacturing, and clerical workers are going to see a drop. And then you can see some titles, data analysts and scientists, AI and machine learning specialists. So those are the hottest areas in computing that you can choose right now. Now, going from areas of work to skills, more generic skills, The skills that are becoming more and more required by employees are those analytical thinking skills, which there would be the ability to collect and analyze information, problem solve, and make decisions. So they're more high level skills that you need, you know, for those professions. And then the ones that are declining would be the cognitive thinking related skills, which they are more the base level or the foundation upon which you can then build the analytical thinking skills. So those would be the ability to think, read, learn, remember, reason, and pay attention. So those ones, they are of course declining right now. So if you see what is growing right now, analytical thinking, active learning, creativity, critical thinking, complex problem solving, and those are all skills that you are going to learn here, not in one specific course, but spread across most of our courses. So you're going to practice those skills as you go, starting from year one pretty much. And the ones that are declining are more like skills that have to do with manual ability to know to operate machinery and things like that. Those are definitely falling. I'm going to briefly now talk about our three degrees in computing here. And so the first one is computer science. It's 3 years long. We offer that here in Newcastle. And the only assumed knowledge that we have is some good maths background. Advanced mathematics, pretty much. And why is that? Well, that's because computer science involves complex problem solving. And pretty much you have problems that you convert into a mathematical language and then you use computers to solve them. So you have to have a good background of mathematics. You don't need to have an expert, but you cannot just dislike maths completely. And we have two intakes, February and July, and you can combine that degree with computer systems engineering, and you can also combine it with mathematics, which then makes these degrees spectacular, really. Then we have the Bachelor of Information Technology, 3 years long. We offer that in Newcastle and Orimba. There is no assumed knowledge here, so you don't need to be to do the more advanced maths in high school. There are two intakes as well, February and July, and you can combine that with business. And the reason why we don't require maths for IT is because you are not going to translate problems into a mathematical language, kind of, or a mathematical computational language, and then solve them. You are going to solve problems in a more practical way, and so because of that you don't really need the same amount of mathematical background. And then the last one is software engineering. So it is 1 year longer, so 4 years in total. We offer that only in Newcastle, and it also has the assumed knowledge of advanced mathematics. And again, it has to do with problem solving, and it is an engineering degree, but applied to software. And so we require mathematics there as well. And the intakes in February and July. But we can talk a little bit more about these advanced mathematics, because we have a alternative pathway for those students who still want to do computer science or software engineering, but don't quite have the level of mathematics that we require. There is an alternate pathway for them to still be able to complete those degrees. And that's pretty much that from me. So thank you very much for listening, and I will be back here for the Q&A session.
Thank you, Alex. That was really exciting to hear about the future of IT, software engineering, and computing, especially with all the careers coming up too. That was really exciting. Thank you so much. I would now like to introduce Professor Liliana Brankovic, who will detail an amazing project on how computing and IT professionals have responded to the challenges of COVID-19.
Oh, thank you very much, Natalia. I will just first ask Alex to stop sharing his screen so that I can share mine. Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Done.
Thank you very much.
Here, no problem.
Slides. There you go. Now, let me see. Sorry. Okay, here we are. Hello, everyone. I'm really happy to be here with you tonight, although I cannot see you. But I certainly do hope to meet many of you in person in the next year or two in my classroom. So, my name is Liliana Brankovic, as Natalia said, and I'm a professor of computing here at the University of Newcastle. My main area of research is privacy. So I will be talking about COVID-safe app that I'm sure you're all familiar with because it has been so much about it on the news. And I will especially talk about some privacy and security issues that we have with this app. I only have 10 minutes, I have 10 slides, so I hope we will be efficient. So I will first say a few words about what app is, although I'm sure you already know most of that. We will explain briefly how it works, and then we will focus on privacy and security issues. There are quite a few of them. So we are basically just present three to illustrate different threats that we can have in security. And then if we have time, we will talk about whether COVID-safe is voluntary or not. So let's start. So it is an app designed to facilitate contact tracing to fight, unfortunately, this COVID-19 pandemic that we are facing in Australia and in the world. It is approved by the Australian government, and it is based on the Singaporean app called Trace Together, which is actually based on Blue Trace protocol. So they are both the same kind of app. So the classical contact tracing, so if you have a patient who have been identified as positive to COVID-19, then what you need to do, you need to interview them. You need to ask them, where were you yesterday? Who did you come close to? How much time did you spend here? And then you try to record all that and you try to contact all these people to get them to isolate if needed, yeah, and then to get tested themselves and so on. So it is a hard, manual, painstaking process. And the hope is that if we use this app, it will be easier, it will be quicker, and it will help us combat this pandemic much better. So I have to say, this is no silver bullet. It is just a tool that we can use to improve contact tracing. However, there is lots of people in Australia and definitely our government who prefer this as lockdown, because then we can go about by our lives, we can have online teaching at universities, we can have economy running and still keep this pandemic in check. So this is the hoping, but however, we can only know how effective it was once it's finished and when we have collected all the data and when we do analysis. This is how we do it in science. We base everything on hard facts. Now, how it works? Well, if you registered for COVID-safe app, then you know that you needed to provide your name, your phone number, then your age range and postcode. So Gavin basically said, we need your name because we need to know who you are, who we contact later if you have been exposed to the virus. And if you feel uncomfortable with that, you can give fake name. We don't really mind. Then they say, we need your phone number because we need to contact you. Strangely enough, they never explained why they needed an age. And originally they needed precise age and then they agreed to collect only age range. And it's not clear why is that needed for contact tracing. So I'm just talking from the perspective of a privacy specialist, yeah? And then they need postcode because they need to alert health authorities in your local area because they are the ones who are going to test you and so on. So based on that information, we create an encrypted reference code. Basically, this is your ID. You don't use your name anymore. You use this ID, this code that will represent the app on your phone. So that particular app is called by this code. And this is how it works. These are two people here. They have phones and they have downloaded the apps. And now every minute or so, your app using Bluetooth issues these digital handshakes with all the other apps that are in the proximity. So that is done every minute. And then if you find another person within the range of the Bluetooth, who also has an app, then you will exchange these codes with them. And I don't know if you can see the rest of my slide. I can't. Okay, so then what happens? You have their code. And then on your phone, you will encrypt the following data. You will encrypt their code. You will encrypt the date, the time, the proximity. And that is measured by the strength of Bluetooth signal. And then you also need phone model. That is also not clear why that exactly is needed. But that is encrypted with a key that actually you do not know. So although it is on your phone, you will not be able to read these data or to change these data. And actually, it is an offense to try to decrypt or change these data. So the app is voluntary, but once you have it, you shouldn't try to change the data in any way. Now, the other person does the same, and that's done every minute. So basically, at the end of the day, your phone will have a list of records that look like this. Then if you are identified as COVID-19 positive, then you will be asked if you agree that all these data from your phone is uploaded to the central server. And then if you agree with that, only if you agree with that, that will be uploaded. And then these close contacts will be identified. And then they will be notified that they could have been exposed to the virus and asked to isolate and probably get tested and so on. If they test positive, then the same will be done. Their phones, with their permission, will be uploaded to the server. Basically, this is how it works. Of course, it is a good idea. It is useful. However, there is a number of privacy and security issues that have been identified by many people. And especially in this document, which is called Privacy Impact Assessment, it was done by law firm Maddox, which was commissioned by the Department of Health. So the Department of Health said, we want you to assess this for privacy. Yeah? And they did, and they came up with a long list of issues. And then Department of Health came back with this Privacy Impact Assessment response, where they agreed with most things and accommodated most things, but not everything. And these two documents together informed the Privacy Amendment Act 2020. It's really about how do we handle this contact information data. Now, in security, we have three types of threats. I mean, we can have many hierarchies and so on, but I want to talk about this specifically. The easiest one to protect against is when you have unauthorized user trying to obtain unauthorized access. These are hackers. They're easier than others, yeah? There's somebody who doesn't have access, they want to gain access and learn something they're not supposed to learn. Then harder to protect against is authorized user obtaining unauthorized access. This is insider, this may be your employee. Yeah, they already have access to the system. And by far the hardest is the third case where you have authorized users obtaining authorized access, but through that, they're able to learn things they shouldn't learn. And this is what we deal most with when we talk about privacy. So I'm just going briefly to give you an example of each three, because otherwise the list is long. We could stay here for a long time. So the first one, Bluetooth security. So to use COVID-safe app, you have to have your Bluetooth on. We know that you shouldn't have your Bluetooth on. Even Office of the Australian Information Commissioner says you shouldn't have your Bluetooth on unless you're really using it and so on. All of the time you can switch. Well, now you have to have it on. There are lots of long list of things associated with it, long list of risks. For example, if you are a diabetic and you're using Bluetooth enabled glucose monitors, that can be a problem for you using COVID-safe app. The other people can listen, use your Bluetooth to listen to your conversations, to launch denial of service attack, and so on. The list goes on. So this is really the first kind of attack. We have unauthorized users obtained unauthorized access that could be facilitated by Bluetooth. Okay, the next one. So it was pointed out in this document, in this privacy impact statement, that maybe way too much data is collected that is not really needed. So if you read this government website, they will tell you, so if you're diagnosed with the virus, you will be asked to upload the information about your close contacts. And what are the close contacts? Well, these are those people who were within 1.5 meters from you for 15 minutes or more. But when you really look closely into the app, this is not what is uploaded. What is uploaded is basically everybody who was within Bluetooth distance, which is more than 1.5 meters, for at least 1 minute, and maybe even shorter, because every minute you do this handshake, if you're lucky, you will catch a passerby who was only there for a second or less. So much more information is uploaded than what is needed for contact tracing. And this is an example of a thing that was rectified by the Department of Health after it was pointed out by the privacy impact assessment. And that was also an example of authorized users obtaining unauthorized access. It was rectified because now people who deal with the server and all the data uploaded to the server, they actually cannot access information about those who do not qualify as close contacts. I'm mindful of time, but I want to tell you this one because that is the real problem. this is the problem is that this Privacy Amendment Act, which regulates the use and collection of COVID data, and it says, well, if you try to sabotage this, if you try to decrypt it, you can go to jail for 5 years. Yeah. Well, actually doesn't regulate all the data. And when you look closely at what it doesn't regulate, this is where you become worried. So all the information obtained from a source other than directly from this app in the course of undertaking contact tracing by a person or employee, blah, blah, that doesn't count as COVID app data as is not regulated by this law. And then also what they call de-identified statistical information about the total number of registrations and so on doesn't qualify. So this is not protected. And if you worked in privacy like I did for the last 25 years, then you would be well aware that what is called de-identified is actually not de-identified. It is actually very easy to re-identify people. And I'll just give you an example of a famous American professor, Sweeney, who in her famous paper from 2002 showed that 87% of respondents in 1919 US census, and that's about 216 million people, could be uniquely identified only from three attributes, and none of them is unique, and none of them uniquely identifies the person. There are no unique identifiers, there are no names. So these three are zip code. Well, coincidentally, COVID safe uses postcode. Date of birth, well, we have age and gender, but we have phone number, which is much more risky than gender, yeah? So what she did actually, she obtained medical data as a researcher, she was able to obtain that for free. And then she bought voter list for $20. She said it only cost her $20. And she was able to link these two tables based on these three attributes and to learn a lot about a lot of people. Most prominently, she learned that a former governor of Massachusetts suffered from Alzheimer's disease. And I think that that is a moment in this century when lots of people became aware of different threats to privacy. So I'll stop there because I can see my time is up, but I could tell you more about this. So COVID Safe app is a very important app that is that has potential to help us greatly, but it is also something that we have to do more carefully with more time available because this was rushed, yeah? Because actually we can have both. We can have both utility and privacy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liliana, for clarifying what the data being used in that app is actually used for. A lot of people, I know myself, when we first got the app, we were only asked just a couple of things, and then it's like, okay, the app is working. So it is nice to have that perspective of privacy to see how the government actually wants to utilize our data and how protected our data actually is. So now we're going to move on to both mine and Cornelius's stories about how we're finding uni, what got us into IT, and a little bit about our degrees. So I guess your hostess with the mostest will start off. As you guys are already aware, I am a Bachelor of IT student. We are in week 13 at the moment, so I've basically just finished off my second whole year of university. As I started mid-year around 2018, this will be me moving into my third year of study this year, hopefully graduating next year around July. So what got me into IT, it was video games and troubleshooting my parents' tech problems. I have spent most of my life playing video games. I started when I was 2 years old. You might have seen tonight, I have a Game Boy Advance Cup. and even just troubleshooting my own computing problems, but also my parents not knowing what to do with their own devices. I'm like, what if I go to uni? I'll see a bit more about what tech can do to me to help my troubleshooting, but also maybe I'm going to find more areas that are going to be more enticing and just maybe expand. Like with video games, I can do a games design course, I can make my own video games, which I've already done in my degree so far, so it's catering towards my interests. So I'd like to point out that you know, like after you graduate high school, you don't have to jump necessarily straight into uni. A lot of the courses I did in high school, none of them were IT related. I did like legal studies, geography, chemistry, advanced English, advanced mathematics. It's definitely not anything to do with IG, but I started off making my own art business. I applied for TAFE and I was like, none of this is really working out for me. So I jumped into university. And I've loved it ever since. It's been really good. What I've loved about it most is the variety that the IT degree has allowed me to undertake. So I do the systems development major, and I like to think of it as like the cute and cuddly version of computer science and software engineering. It takes a couple of those courses and molds it into one major. Though I feel like there's a very common misconception about IT, and especially with my major, is that people believe that it's all to do with coding, and that is completely false. So in the IT degree generally, there is at least 4 programming courses. They're all very different. First year, you have a choice between either Python or Java. Second semester, you will take on web technologies. That's a lot of your HTML backend. You also your front end with your CSS. You also go into databases. That's your TSQL code. Just courses like that. They're really introductory. So if you're not too confident with coding, by all means, it's not going to take over your entire degree. But try to tailor your interests around to what major you could be interested in. So business tech is more about what could you apply to a business. So data analytics, analyzing a new system that is going in, talking with stakeholders, interactive media. You could call it like the entertainment version of communication. So you'll be looking at like television, medias to do with online social media, and then systems development. You could be looking more at games design, cybersecurity, and also application programming to do with mobile applications, and also to do with the .NET framework. So that's a lot of your Windows applications with your Windows forms. So what I would like to achieve from my degree is that I want to break the stigma that females can't do IT. Because when I first started, I had one course and there was only 4 females. It was kind of scary, but I'd really like to just break that idea. I think it's really important to have a lot of diversity in this degree, because I feel like at the moment it is still very male dominated. So by just putting myself out there, especially with these orientation events that I've done, speaking as a guest speaker about my experiences in the degree, I love to get more people on board as well. I also want to break another stereotype that IT is, I am going to fix your PC. Yeah, I haven't fixed a single PC the time I've been here. I've played around with Windows, with servers, but I haven't played with any hardware. It's not like that. So IT, especially to do with software engineering, especially, it's about like solving problems. On the back of my shirt at the moment, it says the art of problem solving, and that's exactly what this faculty is, and definitely this degree. You are given a spec and you will have to solve it in any way that they try to shape the question. So I was given the task last year of make a mobile application, and it was very broad spec. I visit with a team and we made our own version of Snakes and Ladders called Portal Panic. That was a fun little task, but we had to think, how are we going to code it? What is it going to look like? So that is the kind of courses you can expect. But also in the IT degree, there is the fun of electives. So you do get that diversity. If you want a break from coding, if you want a break from doing heaps of diagrams or systems, or even just the theory, because the theory can be pretty full on in this degree with your compulsory courses. But so far, it's like, oh, did I want to do the marketing degree? Did I want to do a communications degree? Obviously, I chose IT, but to give myself a bit of a taste of those, I've chosen those as electives. So I've done a marketing course, I've done a digital communication course, just to spice my degree up a little bit. I'd also love to mention that the university is so great with giving out numerous opportunities for students. I was fortunate enough last year to receive a scholarship. It was the Boeing Women in Engineering Scholarship. And from that, I was granted an internship opportunity with Boeing Defence in their Williamtown base. And ironically, as Alex mentioned, I made it into cybersecurity as casual employee of Boeing Defence. So that is also one of the emerging careers that he mentioned before. And what that brings me to is that IT is very broad. You can go absolutely anywhere with it. Like, I've gone through many different thoughts about where could I go with IT, but it's just so broad. I was like, maybe business analyst, maybe a games designer, something like that. But now I've just fallen into cybersecurity and I really like it, but who knows if I'll stay in it. But honestly, it's so broad, it's so exciting, and you can do absolutely anything with it. So if you're worried that it's going to be too difficult, too challenging, it might be a bit of a challenge when you first start first year. I know for myself, it was a little bit overwhelming. I couldn't tell the difference between an if and else statement or a for loop in Java. I cried over missing semicolons, but honestly, it's the best challenge that you'll have. It's only 3 years. It's a nice degree. You can expand and go on to a master's of IT if you ever so feel so, but by all means, just give it a shot like I did. I didn't think I'd end up here, but I'm almost finished. I'm really proud of that, but honestly, give it a go. If you're in high school now too, don't feel like you have to gear any of your courses towards it or you have to jump straight into it, but just explore your options and maybe we'll see you soon here. So that's my experience. Cornelius, you might have a completely different experience from me since we are different degrees and there's a few different subjects available. Feel free to enlighten us all. Go for it.
Yeah, thanks, Natalia. Yeah, so I'm, as I said before, in my second year of a Bachelor of Software Engineering, and I had a pretty straightforward pathway into uni. I did year 12 here in Newcastle, and I just followed that straight on into university. And in my experience in first year, I found it was fascinating to see the broad range of coding and the broad range of the technologies used in software engineering and across the computing and IT discipline. And one thing I found was it was very intense. From in year 12, we'd always make the jokes of uni can't be that bad. It's only 2 13-week periods where you have to do work, but it's extremely intense, but it's also extremely rewarding, I found. When I got to the end of my first semester, I was so happy with how I'd done, and it was a challenging semester to adjust to a totally different way of thinking than what year 12 was, but it was extremely rewarding to get to the end and be like, wow, I achieved something. I've made something great. And we do a lot of similar courses in software engineering to something like IT or computer science, but we also have our differences. And one of them is the engineering courses that make up the engineering component of our degree. And in first semester, I got to make a phone app to manage workers on site. In any type of workplace environment, we built that from the ground up, and that was amazing to learn about the design process in engineering and computing and IT, and how you can apply ideas and how you can follow the idea through to a finished product. That was really amazing to see. But yeah, I just want to iterate on how broad it was, and it was an amazing experience just to see what university's about in my first year. And you have to put in a big effort, but that big effort is definitely rewarded at the end of it. And at the end of my first year, I was offered a position as an engineer for a software engineering company in the city, which has been amazing. So I'm very privileged to be in a position where I can say I'm also doing uni, but also working in the industry I want to end up in as well. And I work in mining resource management applications. So it's been fascinating for me to see the use of university in the industry, but then also things that you learn in industry that can be applied back to university. And one common misconception I found through it all was that feels like, you know, for software engineering especially, we have a compulsory 200 hours of industry experience. However, I've taken this on not necessarily to tick that box, but out of my own personal, for my own personal learning. And the thing I've found most amazing about it is you don't have to come in with an amazing technological experience to move into the industry. That both the university and the industry really complement each other, and both of them have extremely high learning rates. You take on a lot of information very quickly, but however, they both complement each other and they both can be used within each other. And certainly stuff I've learned in industry can be applied to university, and certainly I couldn't have done without the stuff I learned in my first year to apply that through industry. So it's been really eye-opening, and I'm just wrapping up my first semester of second year at the moment, and I'm just so excited to where I can end up with all of this. But yeah, that's a bit about my story, and hopefully I can answer some questions for you in the Q&A. Thanks, Natalia.
Wow, you have done so much that I didn't know about. That's so good. I'm so happy for you. Alrighty, so you've heard from us too. So now I would like to invite the panel forward, and we will open it up to the Q&A. We will have that Q&A moderated by the lovely Ryan from Future Students.
Hello, everyone.
He will take control of that for us. By all means, any question, go ahead, ask it. We love to answer them for you. Just shoot them aboard for us.
Yes, that's correct. Thank you very much, Natalia. So my name is Ryan. I'm from the Future Students team at the University of Newcastle, and we would love to answer any questions that you have about computing and IT and any way that we can assist you in your journey to university. So we actually have a few questions that have come through, and how this part of the webinar will work is we will answer some questions live, but we do have a team working behind us to answer the questions like as if it was in text format. So either way, your questions will get answered. So this is a really, really good question. And panel, please feel free to join in. I know an answer to this, but please feel free to use your own experience. So if you did software engineering and development only in year 11, but not in year 12, will it affect you if you want to go into the IT field in university? And I can safely say that no, that will not affect you if you want to go into a Bachelor of IT. One of the greatest things about all of our university degrees, and I'm pretty sure Natalia mentioned this in her talk, that we do not have any prerequisites. So that essentially means that you will not be turned away from any degrees depending on what you've studied in HSC. So no prerequisites. So the answer to that is no, it shouldn't affect you if you want to go into IT. Natalia, you may want to touch on that. You had a really good point in your talk about subjects in school.
Yeah, absolutely. You can jump into the IT degree regardless, really. I found myself, I struggled with mathematics and I did advance and I'm in the IT degree. At my high school, they only offered IT and multimedia. That was just a combined course. I don't believe they still have many IT degrees in my high school, but honestly it really doesn't matter. Just stick with whatever you're doing in high school. Don't feel like you have to alter it to get into the IT degree, especially as Ryan mentioned, there are no prerequisites with IT. I know with some of the computing ones you do have to pass a mathematics test, but no, IT, it's completely open. You could have come from a very English dominated course background and jump into IT, which is a bit more technical. So really doesn't matter.
The next question that we have, and it is a really good question. Does Subject Spotlight apply to these degrees? And the answer is yes. Yes, they do. So basically for those joining in that don't aren't aware what Subject Spotlight is essentially an entry scheme by the University of Newcastle where it takes ATAR out of the equation and it rewards you on your performance based on your subjects that you've done in the HSC. So say, for instance, if you've done exceptionally well in an area related to, say, computing, you can actually go online and look at the subject spotlight requirements. So it may be a band 4 required in, let's just say, software in the HSC, and that can get you into your degree. You don't need the ATAR. But what you do need to have is that preference. So you need to make sure that that preference is number one. So we've got another question here as well that's just come in. So this is a really, really good one. And Alex, this might be really good for you to answer, actually. So in some degrees, for example, computer science, you have to do a certain amount of work in your final year. Is this aided by the university or is it up to the student to find employment? And it is up to the student to find that. But as you find when you do get to university and you do start establishing networks amongst whether it be your fellow students or academics, you will find that it's a lot easier than it sounds. Alex, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes. Both information technology and computer science have a 200-hour work integrated learning course. And what we do is we contact local companies and we ask them to propose projects for our students. And then students choose which projects they want to work with. And so that goes for 2 semesters. In this case, students don't really have to go around and chase something to do. It actually comes from the industry directly to us. It's actually my job to try to find those projects. And if you are doing software engineering, there is a final year project, which is normally a topic. It's a fixed topic that is decided by the course coordinator in conjunction with some industry partner. And in addition to that, you have the industry experience as well. And that normally is with the student to find, but we offer all support here. Like we have a list of companies, they normally come to us as well with projects and we just direct the student to the project that best suits them, you know, in their personal interest. So absolutely. No, you don't have to go around and knock on doors trying to find a place. No.
Absolutely. And it definitely is a lot easier to actually find those opportunities. And it's also important to remember as well is that our academics at the University of Newcastle are really connected to industry. And so they know a lot of people right across in many different industries. And like I said, those opportunities to come across are not as hard as it sounds. It's a matter of putting yourself out there and making most of the opportunities to meet new people and to network, and you'll be surprised. You actually will be. So the next question that we have here is how much mathematics are actually involved in software engineering? And this is a good one for Cornelius, I think. Cornelius.
Yeah, absolutely. It's interesting when you look at the maths used in software engineering. You only do 2 pure math courses. So they're the ones with math at the beginning of them. And the first one is it's generalized math. So I did extension 1 maths in my HSC year, and that really helped me. I wouldn't say it's essential, but it helped me to get a bit of a jump on the first math course, math 1110 in semester 1. And that course is, it picks up kind of in the middle of extension 1 and then moves upwards from there is how I describe it. And that's the only, in my opinion, the only form of unapplied maths we do in software engineering. However, in second semester, we do another math course of discrete mathematics. And that's fascinating because that directly relates to one of the courses you do in second semester to do with data structures. And you can really see how the maths from that course is applied in there. So I'd say it's not very heavy in the form of pure maths that you're used to in high school, except for that course in first semester. However, there's a lot of software applied maths that you pick up along the way.
Brilliant. That's an awesome answer. And like mathematics really is, you have to do the first layer to get to the second layer to get to the third layer. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we have another question that's come through, and this is a really good question. I was interested in designing new computers and devices and was thinking of undertaking a computer systems engineering degree. Would this be the best pathway to that? And what kinds of job opportunities would there be in these areas? And Alex, I think that is a perfect one for you.
Yes, it is. Look, I didn't tell the audience, but I love robotics and I love, so that's another area that I like a lot. And so if you like hardware, if you'd like to build your own computer or your own computer chip, then computer systems engineering is probably, you know, the one that brings you closer to the hardware. And so I would say that's a good option for you, definitely. But I would raise another possibility here. And that would be to do the double degree, computer systems engineering, computer science. Why? Because in computer systems engineering, you focus a lot on embedded systems. So it's small sensors or drones and things that have very small computers that require not a lot of computer power and very specialized equipment like sensors and so on. So that's what you actually learn to do the best. And but then your foundation in software development is not as strong as you would see in a computer scientist or a software engineer. So if you choose computer systems engineering and computer science, then you know both words. You know both the hardware, and then you know the software that you can use with that hardware, which is really good. And then, okay, jobs, what you can do with that. Actually, it's easier to ask what you cannot do with you can do anything, you know, with a double degree like that. You can, because pretty much you can create the equipment. So suppose you want to work for defense. Here we have a new hub, you know, with defense, with the new F-35s that are coming to Williamtown. The Air Force is going to hire computer systems engineers and people in computing in general in droves. Like they need so much people now. Like they're gonna need a lot of people. So pretty much it's that. So you can learn how to create the hardware, and then how to create the software that's going to run in that hardware. So any company that needs specialized equipment that cannot run, like their software cannot run on a normal PC or a normal Mac, they are going to need that kind of professional. Or any company that has to develop their own sensors, say to measure temperature or to measure, you know, anything really, even cameras, you know, like high quality cameras and things like that. That's all in the realm of computer systems engineering. And then of course, computer science comes as an extra that allows you to create the software that will run those systems.
Fantastic. A really good answer there, Alex. It really good to paint the picture of how both having those two critical skills of both the software and the hardware really do complement each other. That was brilliant. We do have one last question. I think it's a really important question. And then we will move on to our little quiz at the end. So this question has come in, and like I said, it's a really common question, actually. We do get this a little bit. So if it's tossing up between doing IT or computer science and really not sure on which one they wanted to do, what advice or information would you give them to help decide? And Alex, I've heard you mention this many times. So I'd be more than happy to give an answer to that, but please do feel free to add on in case I do miss anything. But computer science is about mathematics, algorithms, and applying those mathematics and algorithms to problems. Whereas IT, you're basically using already existing problems on already existing software and architecture. So the real differences between the two is computer science is more algorithm mathematics focused. IT is more focused on things that already exist. Alex, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes, that's actually a very good answer. IT is about like putting things together to solve problems. Okay, so you might have like software is not a unique piece, you know, a big blob of stuff. Software is very well organized. You have all these different modules, different pieces of the software that will do different things, right? And you have, and so the IT specialist, the person who specializes in IT, they are really good at finding what are the best pieces to then put together and solve the problem for their client. The computer scientist, on the other hand, is going to focus on creating those little pieces. So the computer scientist is going to, I'm going to just give an example just because a bit abstract. Suppose you are going to create a game, okay? And it's one of those games where you have to have a physics engine. So because you have to throw things, you have explosions and things fly, they drop on the ground, no, they hit walls and then come back, you know, and things like that. So you need a physics engine that simulates the real world, you know, movement in the real world. A computer scientist would be capable of developing that too, because they will have the mathematical background necessary for the physics, and they will have the programming or the software development background to actually implement that physics engine in the computer. Then the IT person is going to take that physics engine and then find a way to put that in the game. Okay, to put that in the game in a way that it's used properly for the game. So they are two different aspects. Okay, so the computer scientist is going to build those little blocks that will then assist people to create their software or to create their solution. So that's one of the examples that I like to give. Okay.
Yeah. Now that was a really comprehensive answer, Alex, and a really, really relatable one too, because let's face it, we all love video games. So so basically, guys, that wraps up our Q&A session. So we will get to answer all of the questions that you've come in, But what you will notice just now is you will have received a little message in the chat, and that is an actual link to a platform that we use called Ask a Student. And it's a fantastic platform. You can basically follow that link and you can pick a student profile. Say, for instance, a student could be studying IT, and you can ask them any particular questions that you have about their degree or about how they're finding it or any pieces of key advice. So please feel free